In honor of Alien Day last Friday, let's make your chest burst with excitement. I'm Aaron, and I'm on a world tour, going each and every place with the mic in my hand. Parsippany, MD, DC.
Wow. You're getting good at this, man.
I know. I mean, the music requests just keep rolling in, so gotta come up with something.
Are they really coming in, or do you just really enjoy singing? I think that's the thing. I think you're like
I pretend they come in.
You're the next Vanilla Ice, man. I'm telling you. Yeah, you're on a whirlwind tour. Oh, I'm Josh, by the way. I stayed in Pennsylvania. I didn't travel this weekend. I had home base. I stayed at the Fortress of Solitude this weekend.
Yeah, I'm sure. So this is episode 36 of Dysfunctional Nerdcast.
That's right.
Welcome. So we got to discuss, you know, my world tour of going to Chiller Theater. And then we had Awesome Con. And then, of course, you got to talk Avengers Endgame. Who the hell didn't see that this weekend? So, very, very busy weekend.
Yeah. If you did not see this movie this weekend, you do not deserve to listen to our podcast.
No.
Tell you that right now.
You are not a nerd. You are, I don't even know if you're a person at this point, because every person has seen it. You're just not a person.
Yeah. I think like this weekend, you saw Endgame and you saw episode 3 of season 8 of Game of Thrones. It's been geek peak weekend. That's what we all did.
I'd say if you own a comic book and you didn't see Avengers, just throw them away because you're not a fan.
Wow. Very interesting take on that.
Yep.
Wow. I think everybody did go see this movie this weekend, man. What'd it do?
Yeah, we'll get into it.
A lot of money spent seeing this movie, man. A lot of money. But before we get into that.
Yeah, we'll leave
what
them.
What do we got?
We got to leave them dangling with excitement here. What we think of the movie.
Yeah, the movie. But as you alluded to in your awesome rap there, you went traveling,
Tri-Fall
man.
Tri-Fall Quest, baby. Yeah,
you're a traveling man. Road trip. Did you take the Camaro? Did you take the Camaro?
Of course.
Yeah. What kind of tunes were you cranking?
Pretty much everything. You just go with shuffle. But I did get the Spider-Man, Spider-Verse soundtrack, so I've been listening to that lately. Kind of gets you in the comic book mood, you know, going to a comic convention.
Right on.
So I could have sang some Sunflower for you, but I spared you.
I don't even know what that is.
Oh, my God. Fake fan.
Well, anyway, so where'd you start off on your wild, wacky adventures?
So, Chiller Theater in Parsippany, New Jersey.
Yeah,
hit that up Friday night, and it was a good show, man. It's so much better than Monster Mania at this point. It's not even funny.
Is there a show that's not better than Monster Mania?
There are, because at least Monster Mania offers, you know, something of substance. You at least get something important. It's not like a show you just walk away getting nothing or like disappointed in as far as what's there.
Right.
But these are like the two main competitors for horror conventions in this area. It's kind of the two biggest. So they're directly comparable, and Chiller just blows them out of the water. And I used to have the exact opposite reaction. I used to purposely, if Chiller had a guest and Monster Mania had him as well, I'd be like, I'm not going to Chiller. No way in hell. I'll just wait for Monster Mania. It's such a better time. It has now completely reversed.
The role reversal. That's crazy. I only had one experience at Chiller and it was terrible, but maybe I should give it a go again because that was a long time ago.
So this was at actually a different hotel than the one that you were at and what they've been at the last few years. It's actually at their previous hotel that they used to do probably about 10 years ago.
Oh, which one was that?
I don't even know, man. Hilton? I don't know. I was too many places. Let's go with the Hilton. It was in Parsippany. That's all I know.
All right. Fair enough.
But much better location. It's a huge hotel. So the way they have it set up, it's just so much more organized than Monster Mania could ever be. And the autograph rooms are probably like literally 30 different rooms. So all the guests are nice and spread out. You don't have everybody jam-packed together in one room. And it just makes the flow of people in and out so much easier. The lines are like not clusterfucked together. They're not interweaving together. You know exactly where to stand for each guest. And you know, it even got to the point where I was like Friday night and I'm like, man, this show seems dead. Like, what is everybody at Avengers or what? And then I go outside and you're in the parking lot and the parking lot is just packed. And I'm like, no, this is the same amount of cars Monster Mania ever has. It's just, it's so much more spread out. You don't notice the crowds.
That's a cool way to have it set up though. So it is spread out and you don't feel, you know, like you're in a mob shoulder to shoulder. You can do what you want. Right. And I don't know. It sounds like a pretty cool setup. They must've maybe heard from that Monster Mania was taking a dump and decided to change things up. Maybe from their own experiences.
And, you know, and parking lot wise, they have 4 times as much parking as Monster Mania could ever hope to imagine to have, because it's just in a better location where they're able to have that. But right. The way it was separated, so I went really for to meet the strangers, and they were in their own room, basically. So they're all right there, which was nice. And again, if you wanted, I don't know, like Tony Danza was there, Morgan Fairchild, you didn't have to deal with those lines because they were in a different room. So it's not like you got to deal with the overflow. It just made it so much easier to talk to people. And as a result, you know, I was in a better mood. I think all the guests were in a better mood. The entire crowd was much more sociable. You just don't have that stressful atmosphere, and it translates to everybody there.
I don't know, man. I guess I got to go back and give it another try, especially if it's set up like that. Because I like being able to go in, you have a plan, and you can stick to your plan. And were you able to do that? Sounds like you were. Like, you had the people you wanted to go see, and you got to do it, and then you could go do your shopping, whatever you wanted to do.
I mean, I only got one for 4 autographs, but I was done with my autographs in, I don't know, 40 minutes. And then I walked around the vendor room for maybe like an hour, and then I was out of there. And it wasn't that I was rushing, but I just got what I needed. I knew I was done. I knew I had a big weekend. So I'm like, I could hang out more. It's fun. But I'm like, I just got other stuff to do. I'm out of here. But I'd rather go and do that and get my things done than wait in a line for 5 hours and be like, well, at least I was there the whole night, got my money worth. No, either way, I'm doing the same amount of things. And right. But I wasn't stressed, and I didn't have to waste time just standing in lines for nothing.
That's awesome.
And that was great about it is they just have a classic wristband. I didn't have to wait to get into each little vendor room. You just show them your wristband. You walk right in. It wasn't a 15-minute process of trying to scan it with your stupid PDF thing, hoping it works, and then it doesn't, and then they don't let you in, and the line's backing up.
See?
Like, ooh, what a brilliant concept that is.
See, old school's the way to go, right? Sometimes you don't need all the fucking technology. Just fucking wristband it up, man.
And the other great thing is there's no VIP lines, which just creates more confusion, more hassle for people. It's just in and out. And right. You don't need VIP lines when the lines are moving. So Monster Mania just screws it up. And then the other thing is they do a pre-show at this one, which Monster Mania does as well. And their pre-show starts at 5. And I would say 95% of the guests were down during the pre-show hours. So you're able to get a lot of the things done before the show even officially starts. Whereas Monster Mania guests don't get there until half an hour after the regular show starts.
Right.
So you could say it's up to the celebrity, but how does Chiller make sure they're all available during pre-show and Monster Mania can't even get them available during regular show? To me, it's like they're kind of demanding that or really saying to these guys, hey, I know it's up to you, but this is what we expect and we wish you to honor it. I don't think that's too hard a concept.
No. And it's really, you know, it makes for the fans to want to come back. And we talked about it, about the Philly Comic Con, you know, like if you're going to grant interviews and do things, like we're promoting you. People are promoting you by saying how awesome an experience they had meeting somebody. And now you're having an awesome experience at a pre-show type thing where everybody's available and you can do more things. That's a cool setup, man. And that word of mouth can take that pretty fucking far.
Definitely. Yeah, so I'll get into, you know, the guests that I met. Like I said, I went for the strangers. So that was the first thing I stopped at. And at first, the two girls were just there. Damien, which is the man in the mask, he literally just got there at 5 o'clock when they let us in. So I saw him go in the room. He talked with the agent. He was like, I'll be right back down. I have to actually check into the hotel. He had his carry-on bag with him, you know. He's like, I just want to put my bag in my room, I'll be right back down. So I got the two girls' autographs, and I got to talk to them actually for about 20 to 30 minutes.
Wow.
While I was waiting for Damien to come back down. They were both super nice. And so I talked to them quite a bit about the movie. And one of the things I was talking about was how perfect the music is in that movie.
Right.
You know, and she was asking me, well, what's your favorite part of it, the movie? And I said, well, of course, the pool scene. And she was like, yeah, isn't the music perfect? I'm like, so I asked her, did you know what music was going to be played during the movie? She said, nope, it was all post-production. And she said she could not believe how well it worked when she heard it for the first time. And I was like, to me, it looks like they're acting according to the music. It's that well done.
It is.
They had no idea.
That's pretty cool how much you can do in post-production to match everything up. Now I'm kind of curious, like, who, after the fact, came up with that song to use? You know?
Yeah. And I mean, she said the same thing for when Damien was in the car, kind of stabbing the guy in the stomach.
Mm-hmm.
Same deal. He had no idea what was going to be played. He just, you know, shot it silent, and that's how it turned out. So it's great, great editing or post-production work there.
So
but I got like her, their whole life story, the blonde chick who's super hot, by the way. she's a senior at South Carolina, actually. So she's telling me she had finals next week. She's going for like directing and writing. And then she told me all about how she wants to be, you know, still in the business. She hopes to act, but the agency she's with now is a modeling agency. They're not really getting her gigs. She has to switch. And I don't know. It was just like a good, like free flowing conversation. They were super personable.
Right.
Got a picture with, you know, them in the middle. I was like, I don't mind being that sandwich. he can call me Tamara anytime.
I don't blame you. And you put those pictures up on the Facebook page for all our listeners to check out. Good pictures, man.
I guess they were pretty friendly with Damien because he started joking around. She was like, I'm going to text them out. She's like, this is getting ridiculous. And then she was texting them like, hey, do you want to join us anytime soon? What's the deal? So he came down. It was only, I waited, like I said, half an hour. He was down there by 5:30, still before the regular show started, which Monster Mania can never accomplish.
Right.
So I was done with them by like 5:30. And he seemed like a cool guy, too. He actually brought the axe from the movie.
Wow. Like the one he actually used, or?
Yeah, the actual one. So he was saying how he kept the props, and the girls were like, man, we were stupid. We didn't keep the knives or the costumes or anything. I don't have any of this stuff.
Yeah, I would have kept those like, fucking masks.
Man, I took it right away. Yeah, so I had the girls sign the mask as well as the poster, and then I had him sign the poster, so all three are on there.
Cool.
And he was joking. The lighting in the room was pretty terrible, honestly. So the girls are, you know, typical girls are a little bit more concerned with, like, is the lighting all right? Do I look all right? You know, and he's like, who gives a shit? He's like, I know I'm ugly. Every movie I'm in, they put a mask on me. It's like, I got another movie coming out. I'm wearing a mask too. What's it matter?
So he's type. So, he's typecast.
Overall, cool
people. He's type always to wear the mask. But hey, look how many people made a good living wearing a mask in a horror movie, right?
Oh, yeah, you can't go wrong. I mean,
no, not at all. They're probably more famous than people who don't wear masks in horror movies, honestly. Did they say anything about like another movie in the franchise or anything? Did you talk about that by any chance?
I didn't. I should have asked her because I was curious. Like, you know, I know some of them die, but it's like at the end with that famous knock on the door. Is it them or mm-hmm. is it just a nurse? Like, is it a false scare? But I didn't think of it at the time. And then I was thinking I really should have interviewed them for the podcast. But when I started talking to them, they were just asking me questions like, oh, where are you from? You know, how long you've been going to these shows? You know, blah, blah, blah. So we're talking. It's like a real natural conversation. And I realized 20 minutes into it, I'm like, man, I really should interview them. What am I going to ask them the same questions over? I'm like, can we just repeat this entire conversation for sake of a podcast?
Next time, just remember to turn your phone on or something. That's all.
Maybe I should have asked Blondie out for a beer after, but I think she was digging my Hollister jacket, you know, keeping with the younger crowd here.
She's probably like, who's this 30-something-year-old dude trying to pretend he's like 22? Give me a break.
But it is weird how nice they were. You just can't picture them being like knife-wielding maniacs. So, like, of course, when I get home, I'm like, I have to watch this movie tonight. And I ended up watching. I'm like, I just can't picture them being, but that's why they're actors.
Exactly. I think it's really cool when you do meet someone who's a murderer or like a fucking asshole on a show or movie, and they're the nicest fucking people in the world. I think we said it before. That's you just said it. It's the testament of being a good actor or actress.
Their prices were fantastic. So their promoter or, you know, booking agent is this chick Stacy, which I've met at Monster Mania a bunch of times. She's always been there. So now she's actually booking guests. And she had the prices. It was only $25 a signature, and it included a free picture.
Wow.
You know, with them. So I was like, that's a great price. I honestly expected to pay $40 before I went. And I was like, if I pay $30, I feel like I'm getting a steal. So $75 for all three, I thought was awesome.
And the picture. That is really good, man.
Yeah, because honestly, everybody charges anymore. It's ridiculous.
Yeah. Yeah, that is awesome. That's being humble, too, about it, you know? It's not like, we're just here to make the fucking money. Get out of my line. They talk to you. They had reasonable prices, you know? That's cool. And that's how you help build your fan base, too, right?
I mean, they did charge if you wanted, like, a group photo op, like, with all three of them. But it was real reasonable. It was, like, I think $15 extra. But if you were to pay for a photo op of that, it'd be easily $100 anywhere else.
Oh, absolutely.
But even while I was waiting for Damien, I was like, all right, I'll take my picture. And they're like, well, do you want both of us in it? And I was like, it's up to you guys. You know, I said, I know the policy's one. And she's like, hey, we're here for you, whatever you want. I'm like, well, let's just do both then, you know, that way you only have to get up, you know, one time to get out of the table and stuff. So they were like way more than accommodating.
Very nice. See, that is a good experience at a convention, man.
Yeah, they were awesome. So I can't complain. And then after that, I ran over to get Cooper Andrews, who, of course, is Jerry from Walking Dead.
Yep.
And I think he is super nice, too. I think he's the person that he is on the Walking Dead show. And like we said in the Shazam thing, it's, hey, who wouldn't want to be adopted by Jerry, right?
I would.
He seemed exactly the same in real life.
That's cool. That's cool. Yeah, he seems like a pretty chill dude. You have your picture. You put a picture up there on Facebook, too. He was wearing, what, the Infinity Gauntlet?
He had, like, this knitted yeah. Infinity Gauntlet, but it had, like, stones sewn into it. It was pretty cool, actually. But it looks like something your grandma would make.
Yeah, I was going to say, did his mom make it for him or girlfriend? I don't know.
So, of course, I have to ask if he's wearing a damn glove. And I'm like, well, did you see the movie yet? He's like, yeah, I loved it. I'm like, all right, you know, I just thought it was weird that he's obviously a DC guy, but promoting Marvel at the same time.
Is it really that, or does it fucking matter?
No, you can like matter. Both. It's just like kind of weird, though.
Yeah, I give him props for doing it, man. You can like them both. You don't have to be one of.
So he's like,
one
so the he other, goes. Like you know, you're a comic guy. You see Shazam. I go, yeah. I go, I think you're the only thing I liked in it. He goes, yeah, I could see that. But he said it in like a real like sarcastic way because I think he thought I was kidding. So he was like kind of kidding back.
Oh, he probably was, man. There was no way he would think that you hated it. I mean,
yeah. Like, I think he was just like, oh, you're trying to like flatter me by saying like, oh, I was the only thing you liked. Sure. You know, like that type of thing. And so that's the way he responded to it. But I was laughing on the inside. Like, man, he has no idea how much I hated that movie.
See, and I texted you. I was like, did you ask him? Did you tell him like how much you hated the movie? Like, I think that'd be great. Just be like, hey, I really like you in Walking Dead. Shazam fucking hated the movie.
He was good in it, though. So, I mean, it's true what I told him. But
I guess that's pretty funny.
But yeah, he signed my Walking Dead poster and he's like, oh, you got Ezekiel on. I got to sign right next to him. I always have to sign next to him. So he signed it, you know, right next to him, which was cool. He was only $40, which I was surprised. Again, I thought he'd be $50 for sure. Most of the Walking Dead people I've gotten at Monster Mania were at least $50.
That's cool. That's another reasonably priced person there. Did you notice any other pricing there? Were there some that were, you know, elitist and going a little bit higher? Did you not pay that?
I want to say like the Tony Danzas of the world might have been $50, but I think most people were like in that $30 range, which was a little surprising to me. I thought it was on the cheaper end of conventions anymore. I mean, back in the day, $30 would be expensive. Robert Englund was $30 and everybody else was $20. And you're like, oh my God, he's so outrageously priced. Now, honestly, if you're getting people for under $40, it's almost a steal.
Yeah, and I'm all for the under $40. I am a cheapskate, but really, it's a signature, and you pump them out, you're still going to make money, you know. And if you're popular enough, then you can charge a little bit less, you know. Still,
I mean,
make
last
out.
Week we paid $40 for stupid Paul Blake, who was Greedo 40 years ago. You don't even see his face, and you're telling me Cooper Andrews is the same price, who's on a number one cable show, and he was in the number one movie that came out a month ago, charging the same price? Come on.
I'm not disagreeing with you. You know, hey, we paid it though. How fucking stupid are we?
You know, we're the morons that, you know, let them get away with it.
We feed into it. He feed into it.
He was charging $20 for a picture, so I just took a picture of him signing it. I'm like, I don't need a picture with Jerry that bad for $20.
Yeah, no.
All right. But of course, everyone probably wants to know about vendors. You know, I thought the vendors, it's a lot different than Monster Mania. The vendors are a lot more into the older stuff. It was a lot of like 70s retro stuff, like old school Halloween masks, you know, like the old Cooper masks. A lot of like old lunch boxes and toys, you know, Star Wars figures, old cards, old like horror comics. There's even records there for you, like a bunch.
Ooh.
So it was a much more like everything was like 70s and 80s, which was kind of cool to see for once. Because Monster Mania is kind of the old typical pops, everything brand new t-shirts, you know, that type of thing.
Yeah.
So it's just nice to get a different selection of vendors, because typically it's the same vendors every single, you know, Monster Mania has the same ones. I'm sure Chiller has the same ones every time. But just going to a different one, because I only go to Chiller maybe once every 2-3 years. And it was just nice to get a different look at stuff.
Well, you look at their...
They didn't buy anything, though. It was expensive.
You look at their guest list, they always have, like, that 1970s show reunion or something, you know? And, like, their musical guests are usually, like, someone from the 70s or 80s. So I could see, like, a lot of more of the retro stuff being popular there. You know, you don't get the...
Yeah, that is true.
You know, they always do, like, you know, Who's the Boss reunion, or the Jeffersons reunion, or Good Times, you know, Dynamite. You know, those are some of the reunions that they've had, right? So, I don't know, it kind of fits
yeah,
in.
Yeah, like, they had an Animal House reunion this time. I can't even remember some of the other ones.
Yeah.
I know, like, Jason Priestley was there. So, you know, stars like that.
Right on.
I have to make fun of this guy that was in line, though, in front of me.
Oh, goodness.
So it's outside New York. So you get those typical New Yorker people. They tend to dress, like, nice, but it's that really cheap, nice clothing that you would buy at, like, Kohl's. And you can tell it's not, like, a $30 dress shirt even. It's, like, the $10 dress shirt. Not that even $30 is an expensive shirt, but you know what I mean? It's like... I can tell you bought your entire outfit for $40.
Okay.
And this guy, he's got these suede shoes on, like slack pants, a blazer, and he's talking, and he talks in the radio voice. So he's like, come on down. Everything I say is like this. So he's talking like that for, you know, an hour. And he's saying how everywhere he goes, he's never had to wait in a line. So this is the first time in his life he's had to wait in line to get into anything. And he's like, usually, he's like, this is why I dress to impress. I get in anywhere I want to go. And people always think I'm so important. And I just walk in like I own the place. So he's bitching, you know, that he has to wait in line. So they start handing out their tickets prior to, so you can actually get into the show on time. Another thing Monster Mania might want to consider. But here, you know, it's the pre-show thing. So they're giving the passes. Here he has a regular show pass, right?
Okay.
And this whole time he's talking how he's such a high roller. And, you know, he just gets into all these places because of how he looks, and he's so important. And she goes, well, you're going to have to wait in that other line. They get in at 6. And he starts, like, flipping out. Like, what do you mean I got to wait? I've already waited. I've never waited before, and I can't believe you're going to make me do this. She's like, well, for $10, you can just upgrade it now, and I'll give you the pre-show pass. He's like, $10? I can't afford $10. This is highway robbery. He starts, like, flipping out.
I spent, like, $40 on my outfit.
High roller. Mr. High Roller doesn't have an extra $10. I was like, and apparently he says he was a politician. So, and then he goes, but I'm an honest politician. I'm not crooked and don't have, you know, stealing money yet. I'm like, oh my God, dude, just go away.
Are you sure it wasn't really bad cosplay or something? Like,
I don't know, man. He kind of looked like, what's the dude from, the fuck, Alan Thickman or whatever is, what is that name from Growing Pains?
Alan Thick.
That's what he looked like. And he talked like that kind of, but a little bit more radio voice or talk show host voice.
There's always somebody at a show, man.
It's, I mean, the New Yorkers too. It's a totally different crowd. Like when you go, you just can't believe the differences between a Philadelphia crowd and a New York crowd.
Oh yeah. They're totally different. Totally different. Still like New York better.
Yeah, it's better. Like I said, I would, you know, if you're into these shows, I would definitely check out Chiller before you ever check out Monster Mania.
Cool beans, man.
I just thought it was a great show. No stress. Loved it.
Cool. Next time, I'm going. It'll probably be the worst show ever when I go. Awesome. So after Chiller, you had to go to another convention this weekend that you had press passes for, right?
Yeah, so I drive down to D.C. for Awesome Con.
And was it awesome? That's the question.
It was good. I don't know if it was awesome, but it might have been like really good con.
Okay.
So the press pass process had me a little, I don't know, frazzled to start with, because they send this email out that you have to show ID, you have to go to this special room that's upstairs. It's like in a meeting room. You got to go to room 209A, and you got to show your ID and all this stuff. And then they're like, if you have somebody else that's not there, you have to give their information, and they may or may not give you the pass. So, like, of course, I used your name, but my wife went with, so I got to get the pass really for her. So I'm like, are they going to give her a pass, or am I going to have problems because you're not there? Like, how is this going to play out? So I go up to the room, and it's at 9 o'clock. They say they don't open that room till 9:30. So I'm like, man, I really don't want to wait here half an hour. And then I like look in the window, and I'm like, the passes are sitting right there. So I'm like, I'm going to try to open this door. Never in a million years did I think the door would open. I'm like, it has to be locked, right? No, the door opens right up. I could have took literally 400 press passes if I wanted them. I just took my two press passes and got the hell out of there.
And we will never get a press pass from Awesome Con ever again.
Well, I mean, legitimately, they gave them to us. Like, that hey, is we're true. Here to talk about it. But I don't know, maybe lock your doors. But then I'm like, hey, if you didn't have a pass, who the hell is going to know to go to room 209A and get your pass? So is it really that big a deal? But I'm like, I'm not waiting. I'm not taking a chance they don't give it to me. I need to get in line for the other stuff anyway. I'm just taking them, and I'm out of here. So that was the fun start to it.
Well, at least it was a little bit of an adventure. You're like 007 there.
But I don't know if you've ever been to the convention center in D.C. No. It is fucking huge.
Like, how bigger than Wizard World or the Keystone Comic Con area?
Yeah, but by far. It's gigantic.
So it's like double the size, or... Like, give me an idea.
I would say double, yeah. And I mean, with that PA Convention Center in Philly's pretty big.
Yeah.
But this is, double that.
Wow.
So the lines to get in, I mean, there was barely anybody in line, really. It was long. It was probably like 200 yards long. And that line, they had maybe 20 of them set side by side by side. And I think only three of them filled up by the time they let us in. And, you know, last week we talked at the other show how it was such a disaster to try to get in. This was literally the second it hit 10 o'clock, they were letting us in the door.
Good.
So really well organized, not a ton of people in there. But then when I got, into the show after about an hour, it seemed like it really did fill up. So it wasn't totally packed, but it wasn't empty. You know, it was a decent crowd. And especially this is the first show I've ever gone to on a Sunday. So I really wasn't sure what to expect, but It was pretty hopping.
And how was the crowd itself? Was it, I mean, you're in a different area It's not Philly, it's not New York. Like, was it mellow? Was it intense? The cosplay?
It was pretty
everywhere?
Mellow. I think because it was a Sunday, it was a little bit on the mellow side. But, I mean, definitely a ton of cosplayers. People, you know, so many Harley Quinns with those stupid big fucking hammer things that they make. And it's like, it's so big, it barely fits in the booth. The booths are jam-packed because all these dealers have this bright idea now that you have to create a booth to walk into it instead of just looking at it from the outside. So you can't even get in the booth. And then they go in there and they got this big fucking hammer and it takes up all the space. I'm like, I'm just trying to look at some. Can you get the hammer out of my face, please?
Need signs. No hammers allowed. Fuck off.
So annoying. And then I got to tell you, these dealers, like, they'll do their credit card transactions right at the entrance of their booth so that you can't get out or get in. And it's like, I don't even want to look at your booth anymore because I can't even get into it. I'm just moving on to the next one. So if you're taking a credit card transaction or you're trying to put something in a bag for a customer, maybe move off to the side so people can still look at your stuff. Like, it felt like I was getting intentionally boxed out every booth I went to. It was ridiculous.
Yeah, like, why wouldn't you want people to come in and look at your shit, you know?
Exactly. They're like so oblivious. They don't even know. They don't even know they're doing it.
And these were multiple vendors doing it?
It was more people doing it than not doing it.
Wow.
And it's like, how can you be that clueless?
Yeah. Do you not know how to run a business? Whatever. So how was the, I got to ask, because it's always our thing. How was the comic book selection and how many vendors of comic books were there at this place?
I would say for comics, there's probably about 20 dealers. I mean, again, the space of this thing was massive.
Yeah.
There had to be like 300 vendors there. So, you know, you do get a lot more of the crap that we're not interested in. You do get a lot more of the prints and a lot of pops and a lot of, you know, toy vendors. You get a lot of just like the miscellaneous, you know, elves and fairy shit and all that because there's so much more vendors in general. But as a result, instead of getting 5 comic dealers, you get 20 comic dealers. So it's about the same ratio.
Yeah.
But since there's so many more vendors, you just get that many more opportunities to buy stuff.
And did you get anything when you were down there?
I didn't get too much, man. I don't know if I just wasn't into digging too much. Like, I've been in such a sell mode. Had a huge sale last week for, you know, $775 worth of books. And then I sold a bunch of Thanos stuff this week because of the movie. So thank you, Marvel, for making that happen. But I've just been in like this selling mode and it just seemed weird to be digging through books and like pulling shit. I'm like, well, I'm already selling 3 of these. Do I need a 4th one to sell? Not really. But I'll say most of the books were brand new stuff.
Okay.
So I don't know where this comic market is going because clearly new books are not selling. I mean, this is stuff within the last 6 months. There was stuff in there from last month and like you're selling them for $1.
I was going to say they're in dollar bins, right?
Yeah. And it was just like long box after long box after long box at almost every dealer of brand new shit.
See, and I
was just like, if the comic market is striving, why is nobody buying these books? There's no way you overordered that many. And if you did, how are you in business? Yeah. You are losing tons of money.
But, you know, we've been seeing this. We saw it at the Philly Comic Con. There were boxes like that. I don't know, man. We'll have to talk about that on another episode, where this is going to be heading. But,
yeah, so I was kind of in the mood to buy like a big boy book. And I, you know, I'm like looking because I had that good sale. I'm like, I don't mind dropping a couple hundred on a book. And there really was not that much there to buy. Most of the wall books were in the like $20 to $50 range, but they were all books that are 90s, 2000s. And it's all stuff I've pulled out of dollar bins. And it's a lot of this stuff was stuff I'm trying to sell myself. So yeah, I'm like, I'm not interested in any of this. I feel like I have everything at this point. And then on the opposite end, it was just really super high grade, like CGC shit for $500-$600. And I'm like, I don't really feel like spending that much, you know?
Right.
I did look at an Iron Man 1 for a guy who had it for only $200, but it was a little beat up. I'd rather buy like a nicer copy for maybe $300 at that point.
Yeah.
So that was my only contemplation. I was like, should I or shouldn't I? And, you know, we'll get into the spoiler of that and maybe that book spikes a little bit.
Right.
But I don't know. I didn't pull a trigger. I'll look for something better.
Cool.
Comic wise, man, I dug a little bit. and I literally bought one comic at this entire show, and it was in a dollar bin, and I pulled a Devil's Rejects comic, which is super rare, goes for about $100. I've never seen one. I've been looking for years because I'm a huge Devil's Rejects fan, and he happened to have it in the bin.
Wow.
You know, perfect condition. I could not believe it.
That's insane. I've never seen one. Wow.
So I was going through. He had actually everything alphabetized in numerical order, and he had like hundreds of dollar bin boxes. So I can't imagine the time he spent organizing this shit. But I'm looking through Detective to see if there's any good Detective books, and obviously right after that is Devils. Wow. And there it was. I could not believe it, or else I would have never seen it.
Wow. I would have snatched that up too, man. That's a good fucking find right there. That's awesome.
There was, you know, DC was there. They were giving out free Shazam books, those movie edition ones.
Mm-hmm.
They were giving out a bunch of the free comic book day stuff. Dark Horse was there. They had exclusives for the show. There was a Stranger Things exclusive comic. They had an Umbrella Academy comic. And then Marvel was there with an Avengers exhibit. You could actually show them either a ticket stub or like your phone queue or mm-hmm. whatever to show that you went to the movie, and then you could win a poster, you know, based on that. So they were there. That was kind of like the exhibitors. But I will say, you know, a lot of the booths that were bullshit, there still wasn't any, there was no bath fitters, no gutter guards.
I was gonna ask.
No popcorn, no marshmallow type people. I didn't think there was any swords there either. So there was none of like the total bullshit things. At least everything here was somehow related to pop culture. No pillows and notebooks and any of that shit. So none of that.
Did they have the Lego minifigures?
There was a guy there with it. Yeah, one guy.
One guy.
But that's all you need, one. You don't need three. Like, they all have the same shit anyway, you know? And I think he was selling, it was, you know, three for 10, which I think is pretty much normal for all those.
Yeah. Huh.
Lots of pops. I did buy four pops there that were exclusive to other conventions or shit like that. So they're harder to find ones. I bought four of those, but that was it. I went for Daniel Panabaker from
The Flash.
Friday the 13th. That's what I had her sign on my poster. And I gotta say, man, she was kind of a bitch.
Really? Oh, don't ruin it for me.
I don't know if, again, because it was Sunday, maybe she's tired, but hey, you can't be tired when you're in the spotlight. Like, suck it up or don't do the show.
Oh, that.
But you could
sad.
Tell she came out and she didn't say much to anybody. She kind of like gritted her teeth when she smiled, like, oh, I don't want to be here today, but I gotta put my face on. Didn't talk really to anybody, was like real reluctant in pictures, even though you had to pay for her pictures. She still didn't even really want to take them.
That's not right, man. That's
and I don't know, she was $50, which I guess is all right for someone like her.
I can see that.
I don't know, standoffish. I could care less about her, honestly. I just really need her on my poster. And I don't think she looked that good, man. She face was all broken out, way too much makeup.
Yeah.
Like overly skinny, like anorexic looking skinny.
She was?
Definitely looks better on TV than she was in person.
Wow. Maybe she was so cranky because her face was broken out.
Maybe. The Stranger's chick was hotter for sure.
And in the pictures though, I think it looks opposite. It's that damn lighting at the chiller. And at the Awesome Con, I thought Daniel Panabaker looked really good. I was like, oh.
I agree. It was like that Seinfeld episode where he dates the chick. And when she's in the shadows, she's hideous. He's like, oh. And then he goes in the light and he's like, are you the same person? Like, those are those pictures. Like, they don't do either one justice.
Yeah, but who hasn't dated a chick like that? Maybe just.
Yeah, I don't know.
That's funny.
And then my wife met Will Wheaton, of course, from Stand By Me.
Mm-hmm.
He was really nice. He showed up early, signed for her. But I guess his handler was kind of a dick. So he was telling the story how they would not allow photos of any sort there. And so the ones I snuck of Danielle were kind of risky because they were actually like throwing people out of line and like kicking you out just for taking pictures. So apparently Saturday a guy was taking pictures not even in Will Wheaton's line but just walking down the main aisle and took a picture of him, and the guy flipped out that he was taking a picture. Well, here the guy who took the picture was the fucking Washington Capitals announcer, like rink announcer. He had his championship ring on and everything. And he was just like, I'm a fan of Will Wheaton. I just wanted to take a picture. So then they were trying to kiss his ass to say sorry, because they're like, oh, we didn't know. But it's like, well, why does he get special treatment? Like, why do you have to be a jerk to anybody?
And he's just the announcer of the fucking team, right? The announcer?
Yeah, you know, over the loud system.
Yeah, but he's really important, you know? It's not like he was a player or something like that. It's like, oh no, the announcer walked by and took a picture. Let's be nice to him now. I don't know, it just kind of cracks me up.
It's just funny, yeah.
Like, he's important. Anyway, so no real
comic book wise.
Yeah, I was gonna say, no real big purchase for you though, right? Not super big.
No, I didn't. Nothing crazy. I got out of there really cheap. You know, comic book wise, I met Amanda Connor and Jimmy Palmiotti. They signed my Harley Quinn trade paperback, and he actually did a really cool sketch in it. And then Amanda kind of did like a little bit of inking on it, and they both signed it. It looked awesome. I was surprised that they did a sketch without me even asking. You know, comic book wise, there was like Greg Capullo was there, David Finch. They did have some good artists there, much better than what Philadelphia Comic Con could offer. It's just a bigger show in general. You know, they have more money, obviously. They could bring in better talent.
And this one's been going on for a while, right? Because I've seen this for years. Like, it's a well-established show. What I'm getting at.
It's only been a few years. I forget what the flyer said. It's only like the third or fourth year that they're having it, I want to say. It was not overly old.
Oh, I thought it was around for like, I don't know, longer. I don't know why. Because I've heard really good things about it.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. I mean, it sounds like, oh, you're like, oh, I didn't really get anything. I mean, again, it was a Sunday, so probably most of the stuff was picked over Friday and Saturday, I would imagine.
Yeah.
But I really didn't spend that much time digging. I went through my own books of 18,000 at home all week, and I was just like tired of looking at stuff for the first time in my life.
Mm-hmm.
So I like just flipped through like five books at a time type of thing, and I'm just like, I don't really need any of this stuff. So I mean, there was definitely stuff there to buy. I just wasn't feeling it. I was kind of like, I went for my autographs. That's what I wanted. It was a long weekend with the other show, and you know, I was in and out of there in like probably 3 hours.
Wow.
You know, and I wasn't rushing. I was just kind of like, it's a Sunday, I'll get home. You know, I did what I needed to do. You could definitely spend all day there and not be bored, but you could also, you didn't have to waste time waiting in lines either. Lines weren't overly ridiculous. I might have waited half an hour for Danielle, and that was because she was a little bit late, and we waited 10 minutes for Will Wheaton. So
that's good. You can, you know, make a day of it, or you can get in and get out and quit fucking about, you know.
Yeah, so overall, I really did enjoy it. Thank you, AwesomeCon, for the press passes. I would definitely go back again. So again, I have the pictures up on Facebook of that. You know, talked to a lot of people there, spread the word about the podcast, gave out the cards. So
good man, good man.
Good to go, man.
Awesome. So does that conclude your wild expeditions?
It does. I talked enough.
Did you, so you didn't get pulled over, no arrests, no nothing like that?
Nope, it was all good, man. All good.
All right. Awesome. Okay. Well, if you were at AwesomeCon, let us know. Check out the pictures on Facebook. Look for us on Facebook. Dysfunctional Nerdcast. Check out the pictures of Aaron's visit to AwesomeCon. Chiller. If you were there, let us know what you thought. And now you kind of see what Aaron looks like. Go and say hello to him. He loves when people come up and talk to him. Go talk to Aaron. Get your picture taken with him and then post it on Facebook, and maybe I'll send you something. How is that? You see Aaron at a convention, I will give away something. I don't know what. Put it up on Facebook.
I should have had the announcer guy do a introduction for us or something.
Oh yeah. Yeah, but you never remember to record anything. I've given you a recorder in the past, and you're like, I forgot to bring it in. I don't know how to use it.
That's your job, but you refuse to fucking show up anywhere, so.
No, you never invite me. You're like, it's like afterwards, and then you're like, did you want to go? No, I didn't. No, I'm not.
I think it's implied, man.
I'm not a real big convention person, but.
Obviously.
Yeah, it's just not my thing.
I'll be going to the non-sports card convention next weekend. My first ever one. See how that goes. See how dorky that crowd is.
Oh my goodness.
Hopefully I can get back on the Topps bandwagon here, get some cards I haven't gotten any in a while. So I've been kind of waiting for this show to see what I can haul in. And then don't forget, free comic book days next week. So
yep. And may
support
the
your local shops, man. Dig them clean. Sell your stuff on eBay like I've been doing. And they always have sales, so you could probably get those dollar books for like 50 cents this week.
Yeah. So that's next Saturday. It's also May the 4th for all you Star Wars dorks out there. Like me. And what else is going on next weekend? May the 4th, that. You got that card show. Is that both days, dude?
It is, yeah.
All right. Anyway, if you see Aaron at this card show in Lehigh Valley, take a picture with him. Put it up on Facebook. Come on. But you can also send us an email, dysfunctionalnerdcast@gmail.com. And hey, if you don't want to post on Facebook because you don't have a Facebook account, but you have a Twitter account, what is the Twitter handle?
Aaron. At dnerdcast.
Yeah. All right, man. I guess we got to move on to part two, right?
We got to get into the brunt of it.
The brunt of it? And we know what it is.
The most epic movie of all time.
This is the movie of all movies.
It's all I heard about. I mean, being at two conventions related to it.
Yeah.
I've heard hundreds and hundreds of people discuss it all weekend. There was signs up at the conventions, both conventions, no Endgame spoilers allowed, because obviously the dealers couldn't see it. But yeah, I overall reaction was overwhelmingly positive from what I heard. I heard no complaints.
Yeah, but no.
That's what you're for.
already he's starting. He's picking the fight, ladies and gentlemen. Damn. Yeah, that's all I heard. And I didn't even really go to too many places, but I did hit a record vinyl show yesterday in Bumfuckville, PA, off, and it was really in the middle of nowhere. And people were talking about it. These are old record guys in their 60s and 50s, whatever, talking about this movie. So it was the most popular thing, one of the most popular things that happened this weekend, and with good reason. And
I think in a long time, like, it just so many cultural things that it, like, I was listening to the radio on the way to the movie Friday, and they were, you know how they always do those countdowns of songs? Their entire day's countdown was the songs that played in the MCU. That's what their radio show was. I'm like, this is when you know you're huge.
Who the fuck listens to the radio? I haven't listened to the radio in years. Sorry.
I don't know, man. It still exists. But
I don't know how. But anyway.
Another cool thing, I mean, I'm a Seahawks fan, and their number one draft pick was on the radio. And they asked him, hey, what did you do to celebrate, you know, after you got picked in the first round? And he goes, well, I just kind of talked to my friend, and then we went and saw Avengers at midnight. Like, that's what you did to celebrate getting drafted in the NFL? You went to see Avengers.
I might have picked something else, but...
It's just one of those things that I think if you haven't seen it, you're going to feel left out because it's just like something everybody does.
Yeah, yeah. And I think there's a lot of pressure to go see the movie, no matter who you are. And even, I talked to people that didn't even see all of the Marvel movies. They've seen a couple here and there, but they're like, I have to go see this movie because I'm going to be left out and I know it's going to get spoiled for me, so I have to go see it. Even if they're not going to get the whole story, they have to go see it. And that's, I think, what really helped, you know, propel it to the biggest domestic opening, right? What was it? Over 300.
Do you want to get in the box office now?
Yeah, just do the box. Yeah, it was huge, man. I mean,
we're not gonna break down this film like we do a lot of other stuff because I don't think we need to explain what happens. I mean, some of the horror stuff, we explain it because we know no one's probably gonna see it. This, everyone in the world's seen it, so we don't need to tell you what happened.
No, we don't. But domestic, do you have the number?
It was $350 million. Now, no movie has ever hit $300 million, ever.
No.
So not only did it hit the 300, it demolished it by another $50 million on top of it.
Right. It globally was $1.2 billion.
Yeah, and
wow.
No movie has ever hit $1 billion on opening weekend. No. So again, not only did you hit $1 billion, you beat it by $200 million.
And what's, I think what really, I don't understand, maybe you can help me get this, man. Not, the movie doesn't always open everywhere. This opened in China. It opened, you know, almost everywhere at once. How did it happen for this movie that it opened everywhere? Because if it didn't do that,
but I mean, the numbers do account in for the openings of those other locations. Like if they were a month later, they still add those in as an opening.
Yeah.
From what I read. So even taking that into account, it still beat all those other movies by a ton.
It's huge.
And it also had the best IMAX opening ever. It was like $97 million.
Wow.
No surprise. I mean, it has the best everything. It has the best Friday opening.
Yeah.
Internationally, it made $859 million. The previous record was actually Fate of the Furious because it's so huge in China.
Right.
But that only made $443 million. So it basically doubled the second place movie.
That is insane. The hype helped it. I don't think it hurt it at all. And again, you had to go see this movie this weekend. It was the largest theater opening, the most theaters ever to show a movie
ever.
And I mean, all these things do help it, but it was going to smash records no matter what. Everybody knew it. If you're surprised by it, I don't know what to tell you, because I am not surprised. I would have been surprised if it didn't make, you know, if it didn't blow away Infinity War, which it did.
I mean, they were saying, you know, movie people or the, you know, the attendance people, that it was the first time they've ever been to like a 7 o'clock or 7 a.m. showing, and it was sold out. I mean, that's coming from like AMC execs and stuff that run the theaters.
Oh yeah.
They've never seen showtimes at those times sold out. Did you see what movie was in second place this weekend?
No, I did not.
It kind of blows my mind, but Captain Marvel is in second place.
Wow. How?
And now it only made $8 million, but it also came out March 8th. How it's even still in theaters blows my mind. But I think they got such an overflow of people that could not get in to see Avengers. And they were like, well, I guess I'll either go see Captain Marvel a second time or I'll see it the first time I get ready for this movie.
Yeah,
it came out 2 fucking months ago and it's in second place.
That's insane. I'm looking at it.
It's actually the first time ever an actor was in the number one and number two movie the same weekend. So, of course, that's Brie Larson.
Right. I'm looking at the numbers now. I just pulled it up. Number three was The Curse of La Llorona. That made $8 million as well. I don't know what happened there. But I got to say one thing about people who said they could not get tickets. Okay? And this is a fact. And I went to a 2 o'clock showing on Saturday. Okay? I was talking to someone who owns a local comic shop during the week. The Tuesday before, he's like, I couldn't get tickets. I'm like, dude, I could go online and get tickets anywhere in the Lehigh Valley. Guaranteed fucking teed. They might not be the best seats, but I can get you a ticket. Guaranteed. And he's like, no, I had all
this.
Well,
it depends what time you want to go. And I mean, my theater was 100% sold out a Friday at 10 o'clock. Everybody took off of work. I mean, there was not a seat in there.
Right. And you went to the one where you normally go to? Right.
Yeah, we went to New Vision.
Yeah, which is a smaller theater, to be honest, right? My theater had, I think, like almost 200 seats, and it was...
But your theater is also like 30 years old, not remodeled.
No, jackass. Seating. Hey, jackass, I went to Regal this time, and it's the redone one, okay? It was the bigger screen. It was nice, right? And reserve seatings, which I wanted to get for this... And it wasn't sold out, but it was probably 90%. But there were empty seats. I sat in that theater, and the 3:15 show easily had 60 empty seats in it. Every other showing at the Regal, you could have gotten seats. There were anywhere from 30 to 60 seats open every fucking showing. But then I heard someone at work today said they had a problem getting tickets and they were in the second row. And they had the that's the
I don't
seats
know, but
they
we heard
get.
Last week with Brownie saying, you know, he's in Philadelphia, so bigger market.
Yeah.
They could not get tickets if you didn't order that day. Could not get tickets.
I believe that, but I can tell you right now, in the Lehigh Valley, I could have gotten any showing all day long on Saturday. It was not sold out. I don't know if Fandango lies just to me or everybody else. I don't know. But if you got to go see it, good for you. It was a good experience to go see it this weekend if you had to. So you want to get into it a little bit?
Yeah, you got to.
All right, man. I don't know. Where do you want to start? I don't want to dissect this scene by scene and anything like that. So
I'll start with just like my overall thoughts a little bit. I thought the movie held up to the hype for once. I mean, I thought the movie was epic pretty much in every way. And the fact that it just offered or it gave me what I expected and what I wanted when I left the movie, I never felt disappointed. And I was trying to think of the other movies that came out where they were supposed to be epic. And it's kind of like Phantom Menace. Who the hell left that movie feeling satisfied? You were like, really? I waited all this time and you gave me fucking Jar Jar? Force Awakens. I waited all this time and you just remade A New Hope? You know, even Jurassic World. Again, you waited all that time and you just remade Jurassic Park? And then I was like, even Matrix or Hunger Games, the way they ended, they were all right, but you're like, really? That was it? That's the end? Like, those were monster movies, and every one of them I felt disappointed or like, really? That's what you came up with? I didn't feel that in this movie. I was never surprised by it because I think I'm such a hardcore comic fan. But the fact that it gave me exactly what I expected and wanted, that means it worked. It lived up to the hype.
Okay. We were talking before you went to go see the movie. You said, if they put in what I read, I don't know if I'm going to rate this as high as I want to or was hoping to, you know, was what you read in there. And if it was, you don't have to go into detail, but if it was, did they then handle it so much better than you thought that you could give it a better rating? Because you were kind of down on it a little bit.
The whole time travel thing really had me like, I'm not going to be into this. It's just like too much of a rehash. And I thought they did it so much better than I imagined they would do it. I thought they basically just showed one little glimpse and they just enough to say, all right, I know where they're at in that movie. And then they went kind of behind the scenes and they did a totally different take on it. And I'm like, all right, perfect. I don't want to have them reenact an exact scene we've already seen. And it was just like, all right, you showed me you're in New York, you're moving on and you're doing something entirely different. And that's what worked for me. And if they would have reshot it, it would have been terrible. Because we've seen it. I don't need to see redone shit in what's supposed to be, you know, this epic movie.
Sure, sure. Did you think it was slow at all? And not slow in a bad way, but did you think it was slow?
I did not. I actually liked the drama element to it. I mean, it's not... I will say the beginning part of the movie, it's not as fast as the end fight, obviously. It's not meant to be. But I thought the movie offered such drama to it, and the way the movie starts off with they set the tone right away. Hawkeye's family disappears and you're like, fuck man, this movie's a downer. Like Hawkeye becomes Ronin, he's viciously killing people because he's broken. You see Tony's broken, he's so skinny and like he's just fed up with everything. You know, Black Widow just doesn't even know how to cope. Thor's a fucking mess, he's an alcoholic. You can tell Steve Rogers is like so depressed, but he tries to do his Captain America positive spin on everything, but he knows it's falling on deaf ears. If you would have played that out any faster, nothing would have weight to it. And the fact that they went through this experience of just like pure dredge and misery, it just lingers on a little bit, but that's to give it weight. It makes it so much more impactful. Like the world is really a depressed place. No one can even function. Even they show the kid on the bicycle with Ant-Man, and Ant-Man asks him a question. He doesn't even answer. He just like looks down at it, at the road, and it was just like, I don't even know what to say. Like, this world sucks.
Yeah. I gotta say, and I have to agree with a lot of critics out there, professional critics, read a lot over the weekend after I saw the movie. I stopped reading shit beforehand. It was slow, okay? And a lot of people do agree with that. And it did build up, but there was a lot of slow pacing to it. And then it finally gets to that point where, yeah, the climax happens, the battle happens, and you're like, holy crap. That being said, it wasn't a bad slow at all, okay?
I don't get the slowness, because it's like, within 15 minutes, fucking Thanos is dead. Like, how slow is that?
And then after...
So
what? In 15 minutes, it was like, bang, it's done. And then it's slow-paced again. That's what happened.
Well, an hour of basically story. I mean, they never have story. All it is just explosions. Everyone bitches about it. And then they give you a little backstory about how depressed people are. So you get the concept and tone of the movie. And then after that, they're figuring out how to do the time travel thing. And they're all over the fucking place.
Okay. I really wish you were here so you could see me making that mouth noise with the hand when someone talks too much. Blah, 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 blah. Okay. Because chill. Listen. Okay. It had like those like impactful moments. And then it did have that half an hour that you got the story. Then you had a little bit of more, you know, action to it or something else. You know, it did raise up the level a little bit and it comes back down and it tells the story. And then all this happens for a good 2 hours, right? And then it builds up to that final epic battle. And I'll tell you what, it worked. Okay. It worked. It was enjoyable, and I liked it because it told a fucking story for a change. This was the first MCU movie for me that was like, wow, there's a real goddamn story here. And it was very impactful, like you said. The weight of everything was communicated very well, and it all built up to that final battle. And these are key elements in any fantasy sci-fi movie, and they did it very well. I enjoyed the fucking movie. How's that?
Some of the stuff I was surprised by, I guess. I think everyone was waiting and they said we would get a scene with every single Avenger in it. And you think it's probably going to be, you know, the epic battle, which it kind of was, but it was more cut up into segments of, you know, people fighting.
Yeah,
I thought the way that they did Tony's funeral, which was the scene where literally everybody's there in one shot, was so impactful that they're all there. And it was like, it was a sad, somber moment. I'm not going to cry like the rest of these losers because I just don't cry in movies. I know it's a character. Like, even if Robert Downey himself died, I don't think I would cry. I'd be like, oh, I'm bummed out. Like, that sucks. I'm not going to cry. I don't know the guy. So I'm not going to cry over Iron Man, but it was sad. And then when you see them all there, I was like, this is brilliant for them to all be on screen at once. I thought it was pretty cool compared to the typical you thought it would be in the battle scene.
Yeah, I agree with that. I thought the whole, you know, finality of Iron Man, he started it all and he ended it all, you know, no better way to end it and to wrap it all together than have Tony Stark go like that. And that final, you know, that scene was really good.
Predictable. Like, I wasn't surprised by it, but it was the perfect thing to do. So it's like, you can't go against perfection in my mind. Yes, it's predictable, but so what? That's the way it's supposed to be.
Yeah. I thought either Tony or Captain America would die. I said that for a long time. We talked about it last week, if we thought people would die or not. And two had to die. I was a little not surprised at Black Widow, but I'm glad it was her, because you can only really have one huge major character like Iron Man go. If you had Iron Man and Captain America go, it's almost too much, right? But having Black Widow die, they
copped out with the Captain America thing. Like, in a way, he's dead, so to speak, because he's not Captain America anymore. It's like you left him in the past, but he's not really dead because you could do more movies with him. It was a little bit of a cop out, which I was fine with, but they killed him without killing him, is all I'm saying.
Well, if you would let me finish, that would have been my third point. I agree with you. He's essentially dead too. He's an old man. He's passed the torch. He's done. He's over with. You know, it's beyond retirement. The guy's dead. He's going to die. You know, he's a feeble old man at that point. But I'm glad like he wasn't killed in battle. You know, it wasn't that type of thing. You had two people, one on a quest who died and another who was the hero. He was the ultimate hero, was Tony, you know. And talk about a quest. That's where it also borrows from a fantasy type movie. They break out on these quests, right, to get the stones and everything and go travel through time in their time heist, which I thought was an awesome way to put it. I thought Ant-Man was awesome in this movie. I enjoyed his character so fucking much. I loved his shit, man. It was funny when it had to be, even though a lot of like it wasn't laugh out loud funny. It was still like kind of he was the guy making a joke at the funeral. You know, where like you kind of want to laugh, but you're like, I don't think I should, you know.
Well, he has that real awkward humor, you know.
Yeah, that's why I like it, because I'm awkward. So, I thought I really enjoyed Ant-Man's character in it, but I liked the quests. They, you know, you had like just, I mean, it was reminiscent of any fantasy story where the group is together, like at the beginning, they're together. What are we going to do? How are we going to overcome this? They make the plan. They go on the quest. They get what they have to do. And you still have to face the ultimate villain at the end for the epic fucking battle. And that's what they did. That's why.
When you're talking about the reminiscent part, I really liked how they touched on pretty much all the milestone movies in the franchise, Guardians of the Galaxy, Thor. They touched on all the movies that it just reminisced and it put you in that place of like, man, yes, that's how that movie fits into this entire universe without overdoing it. Because it's literally just that glimpse. And they did it through, you know, going back in time at those specific locations. Mm-hmm. And then they did it again at the funeral where they're all segregated into their little movie segment. You know, it's like, oh, here's Guardians. And then here's the Winter Soldier. And then the Captain Marvel by herself. And
yeah, the Black Panther and Spider-Man. Yeah. You get everything.
And you get Nick Fury as the last guy overseeing everybody, which is what he's always done. He's the overseer.
Yeah. Nah, it was very well done. And maybe I'm not going to get away from this fantasy movie analogy because that's what it is. And maybe that's why I liked it so much, because I like that genre. But this breached comic book, fantasy, drama, like everything was in it. And they did it really good, man. I am always, I'm a skeptical, and I walked out of that theater like, wow, that was a good fucking movie, man. And when I say it was slow, I was not bored at any point in the movie. Everything did flow. I thought the pacing was good, however slow it was. It wasn't bad pacing. And that's because they had these other little elements in there, the little quests and the little, you know, things. Even Hulk, the lunch with Hulk, I heard like that was a scene that you can go take a leak at if you had to. I enjoyed
it. I hated it.
I didn't enjoy it, but I was like,
Thing we'll get into what we hate, but what I hate, you will like.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Like, I did not like him dabbing. I hate that. That's fucking stupid. But, you know, I just liked seeing him for the first time like that. And it was, you know, he's more human. And it just showed the human side of all of them sitting there just eating lunch in a fucking diner in this world that is a post-apocalyptic world, right? So, I mean, it wasn't a necessary scene by any means, but I wasn't offended by it in any way. I'd be like, rip that fucking thing out of the movie. Terrible. No.
Yeah, and I wasn't that angry about it, but yeah, I didn't need it though either.
I mean, my gripes probably go into more of the plot holes and flaws, but even those, really, every fucking movie has it. So there's a flaw in almost every movie if you really want to look hard enough. And there are flaws.
To explain you know, there's always the flaw thing. Well, if you go back in time, doesn't that shatter what goes forward? And if you change something there, what happens in present day is no longer possible. But then they try to explain it and get around it, just saying, well, if we put the stones back in the right place, those fractures no longer become fractures. You still get a linear point. And I was like, it's just their way of covering up and saying, whatever we do doesn't matter, basically.
Yeah, it is a little bit of a cop-out. And, you know, even when they were talking about it, I think it was the Hulk that said, even if you do something in the past, it's not going to change your future, right? And then the bald-headed chick from Doctor Strange, she says something completely different, and she goes into that multiverse-type theory, which is, you know, big in The Flash. It's a multiverse, right? And each, you can branch out, and that's what I understand, is like there's different timelines. So I get that part, and I don't know. Some of it's a cop-out, some of it's not, but you know what? It's fucking time travel. Nobody knows shit about it anyway, so it's all theory and hypothesis anyway.
I like Paul Rudd's line where he's like, what, you're telling me Back to the Future was pure shit? there's no consequence for going back in time and Marty seeing himself, you know?
Yeah. That was funny. Which I'm glad they kind of put that reference in. It's almost like if you do time travel, you have to reference it. Like in Happy Death Day 2, they have the poster or something, right? Like, you have to reference something like that in the time travel
thing. Well, I love how they were just, like, rattling off all the time movies. And he's like, Time Cop, Back to the Future, Hot Tub Time Machine. Like, I mean, Die Hard. Oh, no, Die Hard doesn't work.
Yeah. There was something with the Hot Tub Time Machine that someone in Hot Tub Time Machine is also in the MCU. So how are they an actor and in the MCU at the same time? I don't remember which one. I don't know. And there was also the Big Lebowski reference.
Yes, which, that was funny.
But Obadiah Stane was the Big Lebowski. So did he have a movie career before he turned into a villain of Iron Man 1? These are the things that Marvel dorks are discussing. I'm just saying. I could fucking care less. But
I guess I'll get into, since we're talking funny things, I loved when Tony called Rocket Raccoon a Build-A-Bear. the whole Cap's ass thing was pretty funny, where he's like, that's America's ass, you know? Again, Ant-Man, I think, kind of stole the show with that stuff.
Oh, absolutely. And you know what? We talked about it, too. Like, my theater, every time I go to a movie, it's, like, very rare. Like, usually I get, like, people clapping at the end. Usually in a Marvel movie, I get people laughing at every fucking joke, whether it's funny or not. This theater was quiet through the whole fucking thing. They didn't laugh. They didn't clap. I didn't hear anybody crying uncontrollably. It was just silent.
Man, I had the exact opposite. I mean, people were definitely, I think half the audience was crying during Tony's funeral.
Oh, my God.
I mean, when there was probably about 10 or so cheer moments. I mean, when they all come out of the portals, people were just fucking hooting and hollering. When Cap picks up the hammer, people went fucking ballistic. And then when he says Avengers Assemble, it was like a damn rock concert. I mean, literally, I think I was the only person in my chair. Everyone else was standing up, cheering with their fists fucking in the air. I'm like, they're not here to see your response. This is not live action. Like,
I am so glad that did not happen in my theater.
People did that.
I'm so glad it didn't happen in my theater, man. I'm glad mine was so even keel and actually watched the movie.
I mean, and then when Stan Lee makes his appearance, people went fucking nuts. I mean, it was cool, but it's just like, really, you got to go. You don't have to hoot and holler about it.
Yeah, make love, not war.
You knew it was coming.
Make love, not war, man. I thought it was a funny cameo. I mean, don't get me wrong, but it wasn't like
when, you know, we always say we're too invested. When those people came back out of the portal, then you see Black Panther come through. I mean, people were literally like gasping. He's back. I can't believe what? And then Spider-Man comes out. And it's the same thing. I'm like, you don't expect this? If they wouldn't have come out, I would have been gasping, you know?
You know what? One of the few reactions that I had on it, like through it. Was, and it wasn't like people like you jumping up and cheering, screaming. It's just like, oh, wow, that was it. That was the only reaction I got. Cool. And then I got like a bunch of like the guy next to me, his kid was like, is that who I think it is? Like, yes, shh, stop. stop talking. I'm like, yes, thank you. Shut your kid up. Shut your kid up, you know?
Some of the funny thing I liked, the dialogue with Tony and his daughter about the whole shit thing, I thought was hilarious.
It was funny.
And then I like when Rocket called Thor, you look like melted ice cream.
That was funny. And I got to say, I loved Thor in this movie.
I hated him with absolute passion. See, couldn't fucking stand him.
I liked him. I thought it was funny. He is my new hero. He's what I'm going to strive to be. You know, it's okay to have a little bit of a beer belly and still be cool. He was funny. I
don't think they were portraying him as cool. I think the team was portraying him as a loser and needed help. So I think you got the wrong message there.
No. He was just like that cool, fun guy to be around. He's like the town drunk, but he's still kind of cool and fun.
And nobody liked him. They were like, you're a loser. Just shut up. We don't even want you to have the power of the glove. Like, go away.
Well, he did kill even Thanos. He did kill Thanos, so I got to give him some props. He did. And he did what nobody else wanted to. He's like, what the fuck?
That was before he was fat, though.
True. But he's like, that's what I just like the transformation. Like, he really, that was a cool part of the movie, how each person took it differently. Like you said, Cap had to do this, let's put out a positive message. I'm Captain America, right? And Tony just goes off and does his own thing. I want nothing to do with anything. You know, Black Widow's like, I want to try to do something. Like, Hawkeye becomes this assassin to kill the bad people that Thanos didn't kill. And Thor's just like, I'm going to drink beers, man. I can't deal with this shit. And I'm going to play video games.
I hated the video game thing. I mean, I don't like those characters in Ragnarok either. And then to bring the levity into the movie of, oh, we're playing Fortnite and he called me a dickhead and forget, it's just stupid. Like, don't even bring Fortnite into it. Again, the movie was so set on the tone, the way it started, that this is a downer movie. Everybody's depressed. The world is literally pretty much over. And then you throw in these stupid humor quips that just, they don't fit the tone whatsoever.
The thing I didn't,
that's where it starts to lose points for me. It's not this tonally correct.
It did lose points for me in the Fortnite, because this is 5 years in the future and Fortnite's a popular thing now. Okay. Are they predicting that in the 5 years in the future, it's going to fucking still be number one game? No, something else is going to fucking take over.
Well, Fortnite 2 will be out. So
I don't even know whatever. It's just, they picked a popular thing now to put in the future that I did not like. And that's a nitpicky thing, but whatever. And like I said, man, there were flaws in this movie. The time travel cap at the end, that's a flaw to me. I don't understand it. It doesn't make sense to what they said, but the overall emotional impact of it all, you let it go, you know? And there are plenty of other movies out there that do have flaws like that and of that importance that people will fucking hate on. Well, now I know it's okay to like a movie that has fucking flaws in it. It's perfectly fine, as long as everything else is well done in it. And that's what happened in this movie.
But he went in time. He went back to 1970. It's essentially 50 years later. He would be like, he'd be 90 years old. And yeah, but he wasn't quite 90. So if his aging slows down a little bit, he looked like he was in his 70s. So I don't know how that's a flaw.
It's got something to do with the timeline. So when you go back, you can't, Hulk said, you can't change the future with the past. And he changed the future by going into the past. He should, like, but no, then again,
specifically say you can't, as long as the stones are in place, nothing you do in the past changes the future. So he just lived out his regular time. And he knew, obviously, when he went back in time to go sit on the bench, he's like, I know the date and time that I did this. When I'm actually 50 years later, I'm going to go to that place and let them know that's what I did.
I'm just saying that is one of the people can go out there and Google this shit on their own and go on these Reddit boards and listen and read. It is a flaw that people are talking about, and you can argue both points about it. Again, I don't think it's that big of a fucking deal, but it warrants discussion if you really want to go into it. Overall, it was a good movie, man. It was an epic fucking movie. It was. That's what an epic movie does.
And it needed to be long to be epic, because no epic movie is short in nature.
No, no. Lord of the Rings is not short.
I will give your dorky Lord of the Rings props, because I thought that was another movie that actually lived up and it did what you wanted it to do. I know it's based on a book, so it kind of has to. But when you left the movie, you were satisfied and being like, they completed like the fellowship. Like, that's what they were supposed to do. It right. lived up to expectations.
Sure.
This kind of did the same thing. It's like, but I don't know where they go from here.
No, I don't either.
It was such a perfect conclusion. You kind of want it to end, because it's like, if whatever you do next, you're going to screw it up.
It would be a shame if they tried to build off of this, you know? And it would be a shame if they fucked up after this. If Spider-Man has to take place 5 years from now. Is that correct? I don't know.
I would assume.
If it doesn't, what does that mean? You know, I'm just assuming that's going to be 5 years from now. That's all. If it doesn't, then I think that there's a major shit problem. You know,
it's almost like they should just make this the Avengers phase. Like, this whole, these phases that they've done up until this point is all adds up to the Avengers phase.
Yeah.
And then when they do whatever phase 5 and whatever they're going to do, just make that something totally different. And those all add up to whatever the space phase, whatever Eternals crap they're doing and all that. Like, just make it totally separate.
You know what? I'm going to go on record saying I hate this phase term. I don't know why. I like chapter better, but phase. Phase 3. What's the space phase? What's phase 4 going to be? I don't know.
Yeah, I don't.
People just picked up on it. I just don't like the terminology. I don't know. It's kind of like nails on a chalkboard.
What did you think about Captain Marvel in this movie? I thought she was fucking awesome. Like, she ended up being one of my favorite characters. We bought the figure right after. I couldn't help it.
If she was not in a movie, I would not have missed her.
I thought, like, just the way she was so badass. I mean,
she was barely in it to be badass. That I had,
she defeats Thanos in a second, but then the second time she comes back, she kind of struggles. But it's like, why couldn't she have just come at any time and just kicked his ass instantly?
Was she the ultimate hero then? Was she the one that really... Who was the ultimate hero in the movie? Is it Tony because he made this ultimate sacrifice? Is it her because her showing up when she did, might not the course of events might have been different?
No, she actually didn't help. I mean, she killed him the first time, but that didn't help anything out. Like, it didn't bring anyone back.
No.
So, and then all those actions are overtaken anyway, because Thanos figures out their plan in the past and he has to undo it all. So, like, her actions really meant nothing. But if she was as badass in her own movie as she was in this movie, I think her, you know, Captain Marvel would have been a lot better.
So, I gotta say, like, a lot of people thought that Captain Marvel was going to be the key to, you know, defeating Thanos once and for all. And she wasn't. Is that a little bit of false leading in that aspect? Like, were we led astray? That's the whole point. Like, why the fuck did you have to make her movie? You had to introduce her because she's the one that fucking, you know, really defeats Thanos. Well, she would have done it twice if she was that fucking powerful, right?
Yeah. I mean, she definitely didn't. Helped, but the movie's about Tony Stark.
Right,
I mean,
which I'm glad that it is.
What she needed, she did not have to be in the movie.
No, that's why I'm like, if she wasn't in this fucking movie, I could fucking care less, man.
When she was in it, she was fucking awesome.
I don't know. What'd you think of, like, the scene when they're tossing the gauntlet around and each character seems like, ooh, pass it to me, I want it. Yeah, ooh, I want a turn taking it across the battlefield.
Yeah, it was a little corny. Yeah. I didn't like the whole fucking riding a Pegasus either. That was a little much. I guess we get into, are these people really dead or not dead? So, you know, we say Black Widow's dead. We know a movie's coming out, most likely a prequel. But they've never done a prequel or a non-meaningless movie before. Like, if we get a prequel, it's not going to mean anything. We already know her fate. So what's the point?
I don't know.
So, I mean, Gamora comes back. They basically bring the past version into the present. So now she's back. She's going to be in Guardians 3. So is Black Widow really dead? They could just undo all of this stuff. Is Iron Man really dead? You could just go in the past and bring him into the future.
Isn't that the
They leave everything open-ended that if they start to struggle or if these actors want to resume their roles, they could easily bring them back with no issue.
And I'll tell you what, I would lose interest in a heartbeat if they did that. I like the finale.
I agree.
It
would be a last-ditch effort.
It's a fucking... That is beyond a fucking cop-out. You just made an epic fucking movie, and if you bring them back, oh, they're back alive again. It just cheapens everything that you do, and this movie now gets downgraded because it means nothing. And I hate that. I hate that shit. I wonder, too, like, in this...
But I was surprised Vision is really dead, it appears. He was not in it, and pretty much everybody was in this movie, which surprised me. And I was surprised Natalie Portman was in it because... The first few times they mentioned her character, Jane, they kind of show a back of a head where it could have been anybody. And I'm like, oh, yeah. God, she couldn't even stand to be in this. And then she actually is. I was shocked.
I was not shocked about Natalie Portman because something told me when she was on the red carpet, she would be in it somehow. That didn't surprise me. And I was going to ask you about the Vision. And was that because because he had that stone ripped out? He's not really... human or alien or whatever the fuck he is, like, he's made, right?
I guess because he didn't die as part of the snap, you know, and neither did Loki.
Yeah,
that's the other way they get around this shit. Like, Loki's dead, but he's still in the movie, so you still get Loki.
That's true.
No one's
but he's
really
dead. But he's dead. You know, Gamora was dead.
Movie, so you still get
in that timeline, she's dead. You know, Black Widow is dead. Tony Stark is fucking dead, okay? And when you see Gamora come back, they like make the joke, and they're like, you had to choose this one, you know, right? Or she goes, I chose this guy over this, you know? Like, she's not impressed with him. So is Galaxy 3 just going to be, like, the running joke of getting to know him again? Because it's not the same Gamora, really. It is, but it isn't. What if she doesn't really like him as much this time? I don't know. Just throwing it out there.
So what do you think about this end credit? I mean, it's a little bit different. There's no video, obviously. I guess it's just a metal sound of some sort. I didn't stay around for it. I could care less.
I did not stay around either.
I don't know exactly what the metal noise is or if it was like more of a clang. Is it more of a, like a Wolverine claws popping noise, perhaps? Could it be Iron Man moving that he's not really dead? Could it be like a Silver Surfer? I have no idea.
I don't know.
It obviously means something.
Yeah. I'm glad there was no mid-scene or end-scene credit. I think that added to the seriousness of the movie and the finality of it all. If you had a mid-scene credit, I think would have lessened it, and I would have given it a lower score for that. It added to the finality of it. The metal clang, I've read everything from it's a new Iron Man suit being forged somehow, being made, to Thor's hammer, whatever. I don't know. We'll see.
Which the rumor is maybe the kid is going to, yeah, I guess that got the watch or whatever from Tony. Will he be a new Iron Man?
That was the kid at the funeral, right?
Right.
From three.
He's from Iron Man 3. Yeah. So it's possibility. I mean, they aged Cassie on purpose. I feel like she's obviously going to have to be a hero. Most likely in Ant-Man 3. I'd kind of be pissed if she's not at this point since they purposely aged her.
Yeah.
So maybe that's just another character that they're going to go with to do like these young Avengers.
Yeah, I don't know.
I got to say, the 13 Reasons Why girl, she was cut out of the movie.
Yeah. You know?
We did get no Kate Bishop.
I was wondering what happened to that cutting room floor.
But do you think this movie, like, what can you do next? I feel Thanos is the biggest threat that they could ever have encountered. What can you do next? Because it's kind of like you've already defeated the greatest thing. So any movie that comes out, you're just like, can you handle this rather easily at this point?
You know, well,
how is this even a threat?
I think right now, I don't want to see any fucking Avengers. I don't want to see another Avengers movie. I don't want to see new Avengers, whatever, West Coast bullshit, whatever. I don't want to see a new goddamn team, nothing. Give it a rest, okay? Let this be done. and go with a bunch of different characters. Why does it have to be the Avengers? Why does it always have to be the team?
I just think there's 1.2 billion reasons why.
I don't know, man. I want to see something different. I don't want to see Avengers, 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 Avengers. You don't want to see Skywalker for 9 fucking movies. I don't want to see the Avengers for 42 movies. Okay? It's fucking hypocritical.
I'm not saying I want it. I'm just saying
I know.
The world in general and
people are
their
crazy.
Greed is going to make it happen. I hate to say it.
Yeah. And I don't know, man. You might lose some viewers, but you're never going to lose the majority if you go that way. I just want to see something different, man. Everybody wants to see the X-Men come over. They want to fucking see that. They want to see a real Fantastic Four movie. You're going to have the rights to it, you know? Make it happen. You know, something. If you want to do team movies, those are movies with a team in it.
I don't think anyone gives a fuck about Fantastic Four unless they're with the Avengers. No one cares about Wolverine unless you get to see him with Cap. Like, that's just what people want.
Yeah, but
they already did good X-Men movies. They're not anywhere close to Avengers, though.
But can't you do Fantastic Four with Spider-Man? Wouldn't that be a good way to go about it?
And you could. I mean, you could do it with Black Panther. There are definitely possibilities, but
like that, I think is better than maybe do with the X-Men. I think you want to see a couple X-Men characters come over, but I don't know. I just want to see something different from them. I don't want to see the same shit because they did such a good job with this. Let it be, you know, I don't know. Eternals, that coming up, you know, you get the other Black Panther movie coming up. You already mentioned the Black Widow, probably a prequel. Doctor Strange, is that another one coming up? You're going to do more of that.
Yeah.
You got Guardians 3, that Kung Fu movie
you can't wait
to see. You know, there's a lot of things coming up that don't have to be Avengers-based.
Rumor was Chris Hemsworth is done, right?
That's what I understood. And that's what I kind of get from the movie.
He specifically says we're going to be the Asgardians of the Galaxy, which is a brand new comic that just came out maybe 6 months ago. So I thought that was a cool reference to the book. But that whole end scene was pretty funny, too. But the way they play that out is he's joining the Guardians of the Galaxy, and like he might as well be in Guardians 3. I mean, he leaves with them. For what reason? And I mean, they're obviously going to have to find Gamora because she's not even with them because she doesn't know who she truly is at this point.
Right. No, and I don't have an issue with that.
They really left him open-ended, man.
And I don't have an issue with him going on and doing that. I think that's a great crossover.
No, I don't either, but I just was under the assumption he was done.
Yeah, I thought so, too.
It didn't make it feel that way at all.
But just like you said, someone needs the money, someone wants to do it. The studio says, hey, you know, we've got... Look, Thor Ragnarok, people loved that movie because he was funnier in that movie, according to the crowds that really liked that movie, right? They liked his more comedic approach to things. People liked him in this movie.
And I like that. I like him funny, too, but in a funny movie, like not in a serious movie. There's time and place for everything. And the humor that I liked in the movie was shit that worked because that's who the character is. Rocket is always going to be the sarcastic asshole. So for him to respond any other way is out of character. So he should say something snarky that's funny. That fits the character, but to just throw in these funny things just for the sake of comedy when it's a drama movie does not make sense. Ragnarok was not a drama movie, so therefore the humor does work. It's just apples and oranges to me.
Yeah, but you just said like Rocket brought that comedic thing into this movie, though, right?
Because that's who his character is. He wasn't saying being funny. He was just being himself. He says one line. He's just like, or Paul Rudd. He's kind of oblivious. Like you said, that awkward guy.
Yeah.
He's not necessarily trying to be funny. It's not a comedic element. It's just he's saying the line. Like, Tony's always the jerk off, too. He's like, oh, you look like a Build-A-Bear. Well, he's just saying that in passing. You're not making it slapstick. And I thought Thor was slapstick in this, and it just didn't fit the tone, man.
Might not have fit the tone, but wasn't that his character in his last movie? So they just carried it over? That's what I get from it. They carried that character over.
I don't know. I just thought playing the video games and getting fat and being sloppy, they took it way too far.
Maybe. I liked them.
So I got to real quick get into, you know, the comics, but I mentioned the Asgardians of the Galaxy. I think that book may heat up depending what happens there. The Steve Rogers Captain America number one, second print, I think should take off. He says Hail Hydra on the cover. And if you remember from the year that book came out, it was maybe 2 years ago.
Yeah.
There was so much controversy and everything about, oh my God, Captain America's bad. He says Hail Hydra. it was a New York Times article and everything. Like, it broke the internet that week.
Yeah.
And I thought it was a perfect way for them to put it into this movie, give a shout out to the comic of the importance of it, but obviously done in a way that he was being a good guy and just using it to get the stone. But I think that book should take off. It's a second print, much lower print, and it actually says Hail Hydra on it where the first cover does not. Avengers 390, that's the first time Cap holds the hammer. That's obviously huge in the movie.
Oh, yeah.
Rescue, which was, I thought, fucking awesome. Pepper Potts in, like, the purple Iron Man outfit. I thought she was awesome in it. Her first appearance as Rescue's Invincible Iron Man 10 from 2008. That book is already taking off. A-Force number one, I think, should take off. There's a definite part of this movie where looks like Peter Parker's about to die, get hurt, whatever. And he gets saved by the entire group of women, and they all form together. I mean, it's basically A-Force. If you want to do an entire movie of just those chicks, you could do it. And I don't know if they were – I think they were making fun of Peter Parker for being a pussy. They're like, yeah, you're a pussy like the rest of them. But I would go with A-Force number ones. And then, of course, the last one, Captain America Sentinel of Liberty number 9. It's not necessarily where Sam Wilson becomes Captain America, but he does get the shield for the first time in that book. And obviously at the end of the movie, Cap gives him the shield.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to get a movie with him in it as Captain America at some point in time.
I think that's the way to go. They did a good job, I guess, interject here, of passing the torches. So that was one of them. I like that. Very well done. Continue.
So, I mean, he had some of those other books. I mean, he does have his own number one as Captain America. I think it was Captain America 25. I forget what volume. That's where he actually becomes the new Captain America. Those books will probably see an uptick too, but Captain America Sentinel of Liberty 9 is the first time he actually ever gets the shield. That should be the book of importance.
Hmm.
That's all I had comic book spec-wise, but they're cheapish books right now. They're already starting to take off. If any of these things actually come to happen in a movie, forget about it. They'll be out of here.
Well, that's good. Good specking on that. You guys listen carefully to what Aaron says, because he's the spec master.
That's right. Pick those dollar bins, man. They're out there.
Yeah. So, got to get into the official rating of the movie, man. Yep. What do you give it?
Going with an 8.5 out of 10, man. Like I said, it lived up to the hype for me. I thought the drama in it was awesome. I thought the action at the end was awesome. I thought every decision they made had consequence. But I'm dropping it because I just could not get over the stupid humor of Hulk and Thor. I just really hated both elements of it. It just doesn't fit the movie. And, you know, if they would have not put that in there, I think the movie is a 10 out of 10. But you know how I felt about Shazam, and those elements of this movie were very much Shazam elements. If I hate it somewhere, I'm going to hate it somewhere else, and I just couldn't stand it. So that's where it loses the 1.5 for me. Otherwise, pretty perfect movie.
Well, as much as it pains me to say, I will score this an 8 out of 10, and it doesn't really pay me to say it. I really enjoyed it, man. It was a good movie. I give it an 8 out of 10. It's a solid 8, like high 8. I'm not going to get into a 0.5. I could, but I took away for the whole... I'm still not up on the whole ending with Cap and everything. I think there's a flaw there. There are flaws in the movie. It's not perfect in their logic throughout the thing. They contradicted themselves. Was it different theories? Was it not? I'm not sure, but it just kind of... didn't get there for me. I thought they borrowed a little bit too heavy from the fantasy element, but I liked it. So that's why I gave it such a high score for me as well. And the other thing was, can they not do CGI with Captain Marvel well? Because I thought her CGI was not that good in this movie either. I knocked it down for some, not only her CGI, but some of the other parts. The hokier moments of throwing the gauntlet around, you know, that we talked about, I didn't like that. So those are like, I liked the, it's funny, the comedic elements that I liked, you didn't like, and some of the things that you liked, I didn't like. That's typical of us. But overall, I got to agree with the seriousness of it, the finality of it, the decision-making, the consequences, everything. It worked, and it was very well done. I think it finally wrapped up all these fucking movies very well, and they did the best they could, and it worked. Could they make it better? I don't think so. I really don't. So 8 out of 10 for me.
I gotta say too, I really liked how Thanos faded away. I thought it gave him like such justice, you know, it just finished his character too. He didn't die in a dumb way. Like sometimes when these big characters, there's really no proper way to kill them. Because it always off comes off like too easy, yeah. And I don't know. It just that fit pretty perfect for me. Like he just watches his whole army go away, and then he's just like, "Fuck, I lost." And yeah, he's done.
And it was like it was kind of like the Spider-Man when he went. Spider-Man went so much slower than everybody else to put in that dramatic element of it.
Yep.
And you know, Thanos is watching everybody in his army die. And he's like, fuck, why was he the last one? For the dramatic part, the dramatic element. Yeah, maybe he should have all gone at once. But it was cool just watching him sit down and just be like you said, fuck, I screwed up. You know, I like that. And I got to say, when he was on that whatever planet he was on and he's out there in the garden picking shit, I was like, Thanos is a normal dude. He's just out there walking around.
I have to agree with his whole theory that he says, he's like, I gave you a gift and you people refuse to cherish it. He's like, I know I made my mistake. I have to wipe all of you off the planet and create a whole new breed who appreciates the life I gave them. Think about this world, man. The world sucks. It's overpopulated. Look, I'm bitching about waiting in lines at every convention, right? Imagine half the line. The theaters would never be sold out. Marvel would never get their money. But like the pollution, the crime, yeah. Everything would go down. You know, and even Captain America loses. So he's like, hey, look on the bright side. I saw whales in the harbor today. And she's like, really? In like the East Hudson, you saw whales? Like, hey, less boats.
Yep. Less boats, less pollution. Like,
I agree with his whole fucking theory. And that's what makes him a good bad guy, is he thinks he's doing the right thing.
Although
I mean, you don't want to compare people to Hitler, but Hitler was crazy because he thought he was fucking right. The sadistical laugh while you twirl your mustache guy is not that scary. So it made Thanos a really good villain because I agreed with what he was actually doing. I don't know why everybody else had a problem with it.
All right.
Think about it, dude. The world is overpopulated.
Hey, I'm not saying it's not.
We don't have resources.
I'm not saying it's not.
It just sucks when you're the one that has to go. But hey, if it's for the greater good of the entire world, yeah. Hey, if I'm one of them, so be it.
Interesting take. So would you rather be snapped out or, you know, blown up by like, I don't know, like some spaceship?
Snapped out. Less painful. Yeah. And apparently they just went into like a different dimension anyway. So they didn't really suffer. They were like, oh, we were playing cards and drinking tea for 5 years. There was a guy at AwesomeCon. He was walking around with a bag of ash, and he was saying that they were his Infinity action figures.
That's too much for me. It really is. Good, good. It's funny, but it's funny once, but I don't know. Oh, my God.
So, anyway, that's where we're at. I'm shocked you gave it as high a score. You're a hater, but...
I know, man. You said that we were at work this morning and I was like, someone said, well, what'd you think? I'm like, I'm waiting for the podcast. And your words were, he fucking hated it or something like that. I'm sure he hated it. And I didn't want to tell you what I thought until we discussed it, because, lo, shocker, I can like a fucking Marvel movie. It was a good fucking movie, dude. It was really fucking good. It would no way in my eyes be a 10, but I think there's a couple other things I'm not going to get into right now, but, you know, if you guys want to start a discussion on Facebook or Twitter or something, you know, maybe I can get into it, but it's an 8 for a reason, and I gave my reasons, and that's it. But it was a good fucking movie. It really was. I left that theater satisfied, so...
I will say, when I watched it, you know, when I was done, I'm like, all right, I got to pee. But I could definitely come right back and watch the very next showing of this movie and sit here for another 3 hours. Like, to me, that's pretty much an accomplishment when you can sit through a 3-hour movie and want to rewatch it again. Because there was so much to process. I'm just like, I don't even know 100% what I've seen. Like, I need to process this. And I was kind of, when I was doing the notes for this podcast, it was kind of piecing it together for me, but I'd still like to just actually sit down and watch it. So I'm sure I've missed things.
Dude, you have
our number one fan today, Nevin.
Yeah.
Showed me this still of Howard the Duck being in it. So there's all kinds of Easter eggs in there for us. I missed it.
I missed it too. I just got to say,
apparently he's in the final battle.
I just got to say, you have officially entered a dork zone by saying you can watch it again that soon to see what you have missed. That is what I do with Game of Thrones. I can watch every episode twice in one night. And there are people, a lot of people that do that.
I'm not fucking Nicole Yvette Brown or whatever from Walking Dead, which she was in the movie.
Yeah, she
taking
was.
Taking notes. Taking notes and like reading them. Like, oh,
I don't
God,
take
I
notes either,
this.
But... you know, I did notice her cameo. I thought that was kind of funny. It was kind of cool. But yeah, dude, you've entered a little bit of a dork realm in that. Good for you. I'm proud of you, actually, for that. I would not sit through this movie anytime soon. This might be the first Marvel movie I will watch again in a long time. There aren't many that I rewatch because I'm like, I've seen it. There's not really much there. This one, I could watch again. It was that good. Winter Soldier's the other one. I could watch that anytime. Really like that movie. All right. Well, all right. I think that says it all. I mean, glad we did another short episode for you guys. But
and I'm going to be back in the studio. Don't get used to this horrible audio. I will be back.
So thank the maker that you will be back for better audio quality. Unfortunately, I now have to look at you instead of C-3PO.
Well, if you wouldn't send me on all these fucking journeys because you're too lazy, I wouldn't have to travel everywhere myself. And maybe you could have hit one show while I hit the other. But no, I suck it up for the greater good of the podcast.
Wait. This coming from the guy that goes, oh, I applied for press passes for AwesomeCon because I want to go down there. Oh, really? Yeah, me and my wife are going. Fuck you.
I'm trying to make excuses here, people.
That seems like all you do sometimes, but we still love you, so whatever. Not really. I guess that's it.
So until next time, me and Josh are going to fight with knives to see who the real leader of the podcast is.
Thank you. you cry.